Good morning, church. You know, I have to say, Sunday is literally my favorite day of the week because I get to see you guys. And I am so blessed to be able to share the word of God with you all this morning. If you don't know me yet, my name is Mone, and I have the wonderful privilege of being the student pastor here at Harvest Aurora. And we will be continuing our story here today in 1 Kings chapter 19, 1 through 18. So if you guys have your Bibles, go ahead and turn there with me. 1 Kings 19, 1 through 18. And I just have to say, church, that I have been deeply encouraged by going through the story of Elijah, and I hope that you have been encouraged as well. But before we begin, let's go ahead and pray and seek what the Lord has for us this morning. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the gift of gathering, and we thank you that we are able to be here to fellowship with one another, to see each other, and to smile with one another again after a long week. God, we seek you this morning. God, we pray that as we dive deeper into your scriptures, would we grow in a deeper love for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Have you ever had great expectations that were not met? Great hopes of something to happen. Maybe you've thought about it. Maybe you've anticipated it. Maybe you have thought that this moment would come and something great would happen, but then it doesn't. Maybe you've had dreams, maybe you've had hopes, and you set out to make those dreams come true, but in the end, you fall short. Maybe you wanted life to go one way, but then it goes completely the other way. And for me, that was graduation. I remember in the January of 2017 where I made the biggest decision of my life to move from Georgia, yes, down south where it is hot all the time, to come up to Chicago to study God's word. And I remember as that morning as I got dropped off at Midway, I got picked up by some students and we drove to campus. And when I got on campus, I stepped outside, I looked at the campus, and I told myself, I am going to graduate. But fast forward 3.5 years, I was finally in the last semester of my college career, my undergrad. And I remember thinking, man, I got 2 more months, and I'm out of here. I'm finished. I'm done. I've accomplished what I've set to do. And then the spring break of 2020 happened. I remember receiving an email from the school saying, we are no longer going to continue in-person studies. We are moving everything virtual and we are postponing graduation. My heart dropped, and I remember thinking to myself, God, this wasn't supposed to happen. This wasn't supposed to be. I was supposed to have my family, my friends, my loved ones celebrate and cheer for me as I walked across the stage to grab my degree. I was supposed to take a picture with me in my cap, my gown, my degree, and post it on Facebook and say, 2020, we made it. But that didn't happen. Now, this disappointment, I'm sure that a lot of us can relate to it. And in this disappointment, we might ask, God, where are you? God, why did this have to happen to me? God, I am so sad by the things that have turned out, and I don't think that I'm able to turn to you in my sorrow. The sermon title for today is called God's Response to the Discouraged. God's response to the discouraged. God's response to those who are disheartened, those who have gone through much, those who have suffered much, and those who have lost confidence. For me personally, I find it difficult to not be discouraged on a daily basis. So if you have ever felt discouraged, if you're sitting here right now in the seat and you are discouraged, this message is for you. Now, before we begin diving into the scriptures, we have to understand what just happened in the previous chapters. So Elijah was a prophet who was called by God. And the first thing that he does is he goes to King Ahab and says, it's not going to rain until I say so. Now, King Ahab was the most wicked king of this time. And not only was he the most wicked king, he worshipped the prophet Baal, the god, the false god, Baal. And Baal just so happens to be the god of fertility, the god of rain. So guys, this sparks the battle of the gods. It's Baal and God. Who's going to win? And in the last week, Pastor Tommy did a great job of going through what happened at Mount Carmel, where Elijah challenged all the prophets, all the false prophets, saying, hey, you make an altar, I make an altar, you have an offering, I have an offering, and whoever's God answers with fire that consumes this offering is the winner. Everybody agrees. And the prophets, the false prophets, they do everything. They're like, Baal, 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 come on, go ahead, throw down fire, consume this offering. But nothing works. And then Elijah calls upon the name of the Lord, and the Lord answers with fire, consumes the offering. And what makes this an even more decisive victory is that Elijah's offering was drenched in water. And so after God wins this showdown of the gods, the prophets, the false prophets, were all killed. And after the prophets were killed, King Ahab rushes back to the city of Jezreel, and Elijah does the same. And that is where we are going to pick up in our story in 1 Kings chapter 19. And it reads, Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, so may the gods do to me and more also if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by this time tomorrow. So King Ahab tells his wife, Jezebel, all that just happened. Yo, Jezebel, Elijah just humiliated us. The God that we worshiped was illegitimate, powerless against Elijah's God. And on top of that, he killed all of our prophets. The furious Queen Jezebel then sends a messenger saying to Elijah, I will kill you like how I did those prophets, and you will die by this time tomorrow. So how do you expect Elijah to respond? Because we just saw that Elijah, God came through for Elijah in the last chapter. It's kind of like this. If you have a buff friend, and everybody knows that you're friends with that buff friend, nobody's going to mess with you on the playground, because if they mess with you, they're messing with the big guy. So God, the big guy, is clearly on Elijah's side, because we just saw that happen. So this is how Elijah responds with God on his side. Verse 3, then he was afraid, and he arose and ran for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. But he said to himself, but he went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a broom tree, and he asked that he might die, saying, it is enough. Now, O Lord, take my life, for I'm no better than my father's. And so the first point that we're going to explore today is he sustains us. He sustains us when we are discouraged. But why is Elijah so afraid? God was on his side. Why was he so afraid of one person's death threat? Well, it was because Queen Jezebel had a proven track record of killing the prophets of God. And when she threatened to do something, best believe she did that. We think King Ahab was in charge? No. Queen Jezebel, his wife, was the brains behind the operation. Fellas, you know what I'm talking about. But Queen Jezebel promises that Elijah would be just another one of God's prophets that she disposes of. So out of fear, Elijah runs for his life south to Beersheba. And church, that's around 100 miles. That's a lot of miles. Talk about the Chicago Marathon and running that 4 times. That's a no-go. But Elijah leaves, goes into the wilderness, sits down under a broom tree, and says to God, take me now, I've had enough. I want us to pay attention to Elijah's state right now. Elijah is discouraged to the point that he wants to die. Elijah under the broom tree is a clear example of the power that discouragement has in our lives. He wanted revival because after the big showdown, he thought that everybody was going to turn back to the Lord, to believe in the Lord again. But that didn't happen. He wanted good things, godly things, but the Lord did not do what he expected. Church, do you know what that is like? Maybe God gives you a job promotion. Students, when you get your first job, guess what? You're going to have a little bit of money. You don't have to ask your mom and dad anymore. But then you figure out that you're not going to have as much time as you used to. And adults, if you get the job that you have applied for and you figure out that the job skills and requirements needed for the job aren't necessarily what you're going to be doing on a day-to-day basis. Or maybe God has blessed you with a boyfriend or a girlfriend, and you think you're going to spend the rest of your life with them, but soon after you break up. Or if you finally get married, you finally are with the person that you should be with, but things go south. You have disagreements. You don't see eye to eye. It's either my way or the highway, and soon enough, your marriage is headed towards divorce. Or maybe that you're finding out that you're becoming a mom or a dad, and you're so excited, and you're anticipating the coming of the little one, and then the hospital bills finally catch up. Or maybe you have a miscarriage. Or the baby had complications and didn't make it. Maybe God does bless you with children. You do everything perfectly. You take them to church. You have Bible study with them. They're serving in the church. They're walking with the Lord. And then they go to college. And when they come back for Thanksgiving, you find out that they are further away from the Lord than when they were here with you. These are all discouragements that happen. Discouragements are a real thing that can lead us to dark places. Verse 5, and he, Elijah, lay down and slept under a broom tree. And behold, an angel touched him and said to him, arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, and there was at his head a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. And he ate and drank and lay down again. And the angel of the Lord came again a second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, for the journey is too great for you. And he arose and ate and drank. And he went in the strength of that 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mount of God. So in the midst of Elijah running away from discouragement, out of fear, out of things not going the way that he wanted to, God still sustains him. And sustaining means to strengthen or support physically or mentally. God is providing when you least expect it. And by feeding Elijah through an angel, God reminds him of the past provisions that he has had on his life. Because at the very beginning of Elijah's calling, he went into the wilderness and he was fed by ravens, meat and bread daily. So imagine that. Elijah got fed Chick-fil-A sandwiches every day, even on Sunday. I would remember that, wouldn't you? But Elijah seems to have forgotten God's goodness. And one reason that we may be really discouraged is because you don't remember how God has brought you through tough seasons. Because it is hard to be discouraged when your mind is filled with memories of God's past victories for you. It's hard to be discouraged when your mind is filled with memories of God's past victories for you. Maybe a victory that God has brought you through was during hard and financial times where you didn't know where the resources were coming from. And now that you look back at that season and say, man, I have complete faith that God is going to provide through all of my needs. Maybe God brought you through a season of sickness and disease when you didn't think that you would get better. And now that you are well, you have a newfound meaning of life, saying God still wants me here and I am going to serve him. Or maybe when you realize the depth of your sin and know that there is no way that you could ever bring yourself out of death until you look at Jesus. Jesus who came down, died on a cross, bled for our forgiveness, resurrected so that we may have eternal life with him and have victory in Jesus' name. Church, once that truth has been put and ingrained in our mind and put at the forefront of our minds, there is no possible way that anything can overshadow that. Now, church, when we remember God's faithfulness, our praises go up. So what I want you guys to do right now, and I encourage you guys to do, is throughout this sermon, maybe right now, write down some past victories that God has brought you through. Write it down, and I want you to reflect and remember of God's faithfulness in your life. And once you do, your praises will grow up. But in the story, God is caring for Elijah physically and mentally. And Elijah goes on a 40-day trip to Mount Horeb, also known as Mount Sinai. And this shows that God did not demand an immediate recovery, but he allowed the prophet time to recover from his spiritual depression. It's okay to not be okay, but it's not okay to stay there. So in addition to God sustaining us in our discouragement, God speaks to us. And he speaks to us where we are at. Verse 9. There he came to a cave and lodged in it. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Elijah said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I only am left, and they seek my life to take it away." Elijah is alone in the cave because at the beginning of this chapter, he leaves his servant in Judah and he goes into the wilderness by himself. When we're feeling alone, when we're feeling down or depressed, our natural tendency is to isolate ourselves, to be by ourselves, not in community. We would rather be at home alone in the same room that we have always been, rather not talk to anybody or share our struggles with someone who cares. It's easier, yeah, but it's not better. Just when Elijah is feeling this way, the Lord comes to Elijah and speaks to him. "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And Elijah responds, "I have faithfully served you, and now look at the danger that I am in." Notice Elijah is not answering straightforward, but he answers with a complaint. Can you believe that after 40 days and 40 nights, he is still hung up on the same thing? Some of us are reading this and Elijah's response, and we're thinking, "Elijah, bro, get over it. Let it go." Because I thought that way too. And then it hit me. How many times have you replayed a scenario over and over and over again in your head? Maybe you're like Elijah, where you've been replaying the same thing over and over and over for 40 days. And for some of us, even 40 years. You might not be in the same boat as Elijah, or you may be. But it's hard for Elijah to see past his own perspective. Elijah is speaking. He is preaching to himself his own story. Are you finding yourself in a similar situation where it's you taking longer than expected to get over something? Maybe it's beating yourself up over a decision in life where you think you're going to go one way and you think that's the best way to go, and you go down that path and then you realize, "I'm miserable here. I wish I would have chose the other path." Or maybe it's the fact that somebody has done you wrong. Do you need to find forgiveness to let go of the things that you are holding on to that you shouldn't be? Are you preaching to yourself your own story and not looking at what God is doing? Verse 11. And he said, God said, "Go out and stand on the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind, and after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake, and after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire, and after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face on his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts. For the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only am left, and they seek my life to take it away." At this point, Elijah wasn't going to change. And he knew, and God knew, that he needed to refresh his memory, remind him of who he was actually talking to, who he was worshiping. And God tells Elijah to go and stand on the mountain for the Lord to pass by. But the funny thing is that Elijah doesn't move. There was a wind, an earthquake, a fire that happened, but the Lord was not in any of that. God had previously shown Moses on Mount Sinai his glory through nature, but he is not with Elijah. Even though there was a strong wind, an earthquake, a fire, God was not in any of that, but he shows up in a quiet whisper. Notice God asking Elijah the same thing twice. And usually when there's repetition in Scripture, there's a meaning behind that. When God asks Elijah the same question twice, he is not asking for an answer. He's not seeking an answer, but he's rather looking if he has changed his heart or not. But in the same way of repetition, Elijah answers in the same way that he has always been, proving that he has not changed. He is still stuck in his own ways, his own sorrows, and he is self-centered. How has God been speaking in your life? A lot of the times we want God to show up in the big things, in big ways. But God speaks through us, to us, through small whispers. In the stillness of him speaking to you, are you listening? In church, God speaks to us even now. And I have three things and three ways how God speaks to us. Number one, his word. Do you guys know that all of Scripture is inspired by God, that it is breathed out by the one true God? God is speaking to us through his word. How can we expect God, and how do we say that God is silent when our Bibles are closed? How can we say he's silent when we don't open his word that he is talking, speaking to us? Secondly, he speaks through the church. We are called to love one another, encouraging one another, to build one another up. Are we doing that? Are you in need of encouragement and building up? Are you encouraging somebody else? And he speaks through his Spirit. That's the last thing. The Spirit teaches, he reveals, he reminds us of God, and the Spirit talks in that small voice inside your head that is leading you. God may not be showing you in big ways where he's coming from, but he is showing you nonetheless. And finally, after speaking to us, even though Elijah may be at the end of his rope, he doesn't want to go anymore, God isn't finished with him. Because God sends us. He sends us. He appoints and he redirects us. Verse 15. And the Lord said to him, "Go, return your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, you shall appoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu, the son of Nimshi, you shall appoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel-Mela, you shall anoint to be prophet in your place. And the one who escapes from the sword of Haziel shall Jehu put to death. And the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha put to death. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him. So even though Elijah is discouraged, God commands Elijah to turn back and to serve the Lord, to anoint kings, and to bring Elisha on as a prophet. That sounds a little bit familiar. We have Elijah, and then he's going to appoint Elisha. Elijah, Elisha. There's a difference, but they sound similar. But this was to reveal what God has been doing all along. God has been working in the background all along. He has been raising up people to take places of those who are currently in a position. And God can still use you for his glory when you're discouraged. Even when Elijah was at his end, God is still using him for his glory. And after God reveals that Elijah, what Elijah is to do next, he responds directly to Elijah's comment earlier about being alone. And he says that you are not alone. There are 7,000 that have gone through the struggle just like you, Elijah. So what is God trying to do? What is the point that God is trying to make here? God is challenging Elijah to get off his high horse. Just because God is not acting in the way that he thinks God should act, doesn't mean that God is not acting at all. God is doing so many things in the background that we are not aware of. Have you ever looked back at your struggles and noticed that those are some of the most formative times in your faith? It may not be the same struggle. It may be a different scenario. But we have the same God who's going to walk through it all with us. Amen? After not having graduation, Kayla and I had a beautiful small wedding. And we started our lives as husband and wife. And if you guys know fairy tales, once the prince and the princess get married, that's happily ever after, right? I hear laughter because married people, you know this ain't true. This is actually the beginning of when the trials actually begin. And one of those beginning trials that we had to face together was unemployment. For the first 8 months of my marriage, Kayla and I had no idea how we were going to pay for the utilities or even rent or insurance. But somehow, some way, God has provided without fail. And looking back, that was one of the most darkest times in my life, because I was preaching to myself all the things that were wrong, all the things that have gone wrong, and all the things that should have been. But do you know what I learned through those hardships about God? Church, do we know what God is teaching us through those hardships and trials that we are facing? God is teaching you that through your hardships and trials, God is holding you. God is holding us. It's like a child who holds on to their father when they're scared. And it doesn't matter how hard or how strong the child is holding on to the father. What matters is how tightly the father is holding on to the child. That is what God is like. He is holding on to us. So did you guys notice how Elijah responds to his circumstances? He chooses to stay bitter and he remains bitter. And what God told him to do, he never anoints any kings. He does bring on Elisha as a new prophet, but his ministry was barren because of his bitterness. So in this story of Elijah, what can we take from this particular passage in Scripture? And here's the point. You can remain bitter because that's an option, or you can decide to trust in Jesus, trust in God, that his ways are greater and his ways are far better than ours. I know it's July, but let's think about something that's a little bit cooler. I'm talking about Christmas. The Grinch. Something happens to this furry green guy when he was younger, and he remains bitter through it all. So what did he do? He climbed up a mountain, he isolated himself from his town, his community, and stayed there for years until one day where everything changed. But it took him a while to get there. But he was reminded of the joys that he can have through these hardships. So likewise, like Elijah, like the Grinch, like you, like me, sometimes it takes subtle reminders, like a whisper from God, to hear, to see better, and to trust God. So today, church, I encourage you to let God speak to you, to let God sustain you, and to be open to his redirection of your life. Now, what is that one thing for you today? Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you for your word, and we thank you, God, for the blessing that it is to know you and to read your word. God, we thank you that you sustain us even through our hard times. We thank you that you speak to us and that you are sending us and you are using us for your glory. God, today I pray that you would be with us, Lord. Whatever things that were stirred up, whatever things that we have remembered, that we are holding on to so tightly, whatever thing that we are preaching to ourselves that is not of you, Lord, I pray that we would give that to you. Help remind us of your goodness in all things that we are doing. God, help us to have a better perspective. And God, we thank you once again. And we praise you. And we lift this all up to you in Jesus' name. Amen.